Welcome back to our study on the book of Proverbs. Today, we're going to go into the 9th and 10th addresses. So the final two addresses from father to son, from Solomon to his children and to you. So open your Bibles, get to Proverbs chapter 6. We're going to start with the 9th address, which is verses 20 to 35. I'll bring it up on the screen here also. And then once we get going on that, we will get into chapter 7 and end today with the 10th and final address from father to son. So join with me, will you, as we switch to our screen here. So Solomon begins with warnings against adultery. My son, keep your father's commandment and forsake not your mother's teaching. This is a nearly identical opening to the first address in chapter 1, verse 8. And Solomon here tells his son, tells us to internalize the instructions. He says, bind them upon your heart always. So here when he says heart, Solomon is saying internalize it, bring it into, have it with you. So when we talk about meditating on God's word, when we talk about memorizing scripture, having it with us at all times, bind it on your heart always. And then when he talks about tying it around your neck, he's saying show it in your actions. So as your neck shows out to the world, think about it that way. So internalize his word and then live it out. Show it to the world. So in his first, just like his first address here in the 9th address, Solomon is saying internalize his instructions and show your actions to the world. Live it out. Here in chapter 6, he begins to pile up the metaphors. So he talks about when you walk, they'll lead you. When you lie down, they'll watch over you when you awake. Verse 23, the commandment is a lamp and a teaching a light. Okay, then he brings in to preserve you from the evil woman. So he's piling up metaphors to reinforce the value of the instruction to protect against the adulteress. So divine instruction is personified as a woman. Then it's like a light source and it's the path of life. So you notice that in verses 22 and 23 here, walking the path, and then a lamp, teaching a light, and the discipline are a way of life. So we continue on to say that this is not merely personal advice. This isn't just a little personal, like, hey, this is kind of the best way I've seen to live, but this is divine wisdom itself. Psalm 119, verse 105. I'm sure you know that one well, but if you don't have it memorized, right, with your heart, Psalm 119, verse 105 reads this specifically. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. The path, of course, is Jesus, as he says in John 14, verse 6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So the parents here are guiding the son by the gospel promise of God. That gospel promise then will protect and empower their son to not give in to the temptation of adultery. So Solomon is not relying upon his personal wisdom or his own experiences, and we'll get to that a little bit later as you know the life of Solomon. But Solomon is saying, my son, what is going to keep you on the path, what is going to protect you, what's going to be with you is the gospel. The good news of God's promises, of his salvation, of him leading the way, of his word guiding us. So he's saying, take that word, internalize it permanently, and then live it out in the world, and that will be your protection. So it's not the commands in 6:21 where he says, bind them and tie them. Those aren't the ones that impart the power. It's the promises of verses 22 to 24. This is back to law, gospel, what we Lutherans talk about a lot with law and gospel. How do we use law, gospel? God's law commands us to do what's right, most obviously in the Ten Commandments. But only the gospel gives us the ability, the power to believe and obey. So the law tells us what to do, but we need God's Holy Spirit in order to do it. So he starts off with the command, do this. But then he says, look, this is the promise of his word. This is what it will do for you. The Holy Spirit empowers us to believe and obey. That's why we continue to study God's word, to go to church, to read his word. So now we're back to three warnings being given in this address. Verses 25 and 26, Solomon says the price of an affair with a married woman is high. Verses 27 to 31, he says adultery will cost you all you have. In verses 32 to 35, he says committing adultery shows a lack of sense. So first of all, verse 25, let's bring that back up for you to read that. Don't allow beauty to cloud your judgment. 26 is kind of difficult to understand sometimes, but it seems to say that adultery will actually cost you your life. So let's look at those first. Do not desire her beauty in your heart, and do not let her capture you with her eyelashes. For the price of a prostitute is only a loaf of bread, but a married woman hunts down a precious life. So don't allow beauty to cloud your judgment. So looking at the outer side, remember how God looked at King David, said, I looked at the heart. And it seems to say that this adultery with a married woman will cost you your life. Adultery, in verses 27 to 31, adultery will cost you all that you have. It's like playing with fire. And you'll be punished even more than a needy thief. So reading it here says, he's talking about fire. Can a man carry fire next to his chest and his clothes and not be burned? Can he walk on hot coals, not be scorched? He's comparing this. So it is he who goes into his neighbor's wife. None who touches her will go unpunished. It's like carrying fire next to your chest. You're going to get punished. You're going to get hurt. So you might think you're getting away with it, but God sees all. He knows all. You're going to be punished. Solomon then goes on to say, look, people don't despise a thief if he steals to satisfy his appetite when he's hungry. So he's not saying it's right to do it. But he's saying the way people look at a thief who's just trying to live, well, they're not despising him. They say, but even then, if he's caught as a thief, he's going to pay. He's going to pay with everything. He'll pay sevenfold. But then he goes on to say, he who commits adultery lacks sense. And that's back to our next one here. Adultery has inescapable consequences. Physical and reputation. Revenge from the husbands. So look at that with me again. He lacks sense. It destroys himself. He will get wounds and dishonor. He will have disgrace because jealousy will make a man furious and he will not spare when he takes revenge. He will not accept compensation. He will refuse though you multiply gifts. So even though you're trying to pay off the husband that you've committed this affair against, God says, look, he's not going to take anything for this. He's upset. He's jealous. He's angry. You're going to be in trouble. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 4, going into the New Testament here. God says, let marriage be held in honor among all, and let the marriage bed be undefiled, for God will judge the sexually immoral and adulterous. And we see that throughout Scripture, of course. But adultery has inescapable consequences, earthly and eternally. What Solomon is saying is, look, unfaithfulness here in your marriage often manifests itself in multiple ways in this life. Multiple ways. And I think we see that all around us with people that commit adultery or anything like that. It costs so much. So Solomon is urging restraint from sexual temptation. He's urging restraint from idolatry, because what are you idolizing when you're being sexually immoral? You're not idolizing God. You're idolizing your wants, your desires, your needs. And it's also unfaithfulness to wisdom, to God. You're being unfaithful in all that you do. All right, so that's the ninth address. It's all about adultery. Solomon is warning his son, don't go commit adultery. There'll be many, many issues with that. All right, so then, chapter 7, the 10th address to a son. Solomon is keeping with the adultery part. Wisdom will keep you from adultery, thus it will keep you from death. So chapter 7 is really divided into three different sections. Here you've got the opening admonition. You've got an incident that the father observed, so the father is admonishing his son to avoid it. Then he says, now look at this situation. He points out what's happening. And then it's the closing warning. So the opening admonition is verses 1 through 5. Let's look at that here for just a minute. He's admonishing his son. Keep my words, treasure up my commandments with you. Keep my commandments and live. Keep my teaching as the apple of your eye. Bind them on your fingers, write them on the tablet of your heart. Say to wisdom, you are my sister, and call insight your intimate friend, to keep you from the forbidden woman, from the adulteress with her smooth words. So as in previous addresses, the promise of life is attached. The son is to accept these teachings in order to shape his behavior, his fingers, and internalize them, his heart. So there we get the parts of the body once again. His fingers to shape his behavior, right? Bind them on your fingers. So the way you work, the way you act, the way you do things, let it shape your actions. Write them on the tablets of your hearts. Internalize them. Solomon is all about internalize these teachings and let them flow out from you into the world in the way that you act. Wisdom is to be called my sister and my relative. That means the son should marry himself to wisdom. Now that seems weird. Why are we saying sister? Why not wife or something? Well, Solomon calls his bride my sister in his song, Song of Solomon, chapter 4, verses 9 and 10. It's just another way, culturally different. Remember, we're speaking here about 3,500, 3,600 years later, different cultures, different understandings. We talk about being brothers and sisters in Christ. My wife is my sister in Christ and my wife, but it's just to understand that there are different cultures, different ways they look at it. So what he's saying here in chapter 7, say to wisdom, you are my sister. Saying you're my relative, you're my wife. Marry yourself to wisdom. Be so intimately connected to wisdom that you are inseparable. Live it out, be together. Everything that you do should be for wisdom and because of wisdom, acting together as one. So now, in verses 6 through 23, the father observes something, and he's telling his son all about it. The point drives home his previous address in that he picks out a man who is without sense. So there's a lot, but look, he says, at the window of my house, I've looked out through my lattice. Now, they didn't have windows back then. Okay? They didn't have glass, so they had a lattice to keep the birds out. So he's looking out through the lattice, which means he can also hear what's going on. Says, I've seen, and goes on to tell his son the things that he's seen. A young man lacking sense. He's passing along near her corner. He's taking the road to her house. Now remember, as we talk about places and the path, he's walking the road to her house. He's in the twilight, in the evening. Look at that. What time is it? It's night time. It's darkness. Are we in light? No. Are we on the path of wisdom? No. Now what happens though? The woman meets him. And how is she dressed? Like a prostitute. She's wily of heart, it says. She is loud. She's calling out. Wisdom calls out, but not on the corner. She's loud. She's wayward. Her feet do not stay at home. So now in the streets, now in the market, just like wisdom, at every corner, she lies in wait. Does wisdom lie in wait for us to attack? No. The woman seizes him, kisses him. With bold face, she says, listen to this lie. I had to offer sacrifices, and today I have paid my vows, so now I've come out to meet you. Oh, drawing him in, I came out to meet you. To seek you eagerly, and I have found you. Oh, and she's even spread her couch with coverings, with colored linens from Egyptian linen. She perfumed her bed with myrrh and aloes and cinnamon. And she says, come, let us take our fill of love till morning. Let us delight ourselves with love. For my husband is not at home. He has gone on a long journey. He took a bag of money with him. At full moon, he will come home. Right? And Solomon goes on to say, look, there's seductive speech. She persuades him. But where was he? He was on the path to her house at night. With her smooth talk, she compels him. All at once, he follows her. Like what? An ox to the slaughter? Or a stag caught fast till an arrow pierces its liver? A bird rushes into its snare? He doesn't know it will cost him his life. All right. So, let's go through this a little bit. Solomon picks out a man who's without sense. The young man's path is the wrong one, and it places him at the wrong location at the wrong time. Watch how you're walking. If you're on the wrong path, you're going to end up in the wrong place at the wrong time. It's going to catch you. The woman is loud. She's rebellious against the sixth commandment. She is straying from home, as is the young man. The similarities between this woman and wisdom are important. Both are outside. Both are calling in the open squares. Why is that important? It signals to us, the reader, to discern between the two. Make appropriate choices. They're both calling out to us in this world. Wisdom and the adulteress, the seduction, Satan, right? But wisdom is never found on the street corner, and wisdom never ambushes or lies in wait. It's there for everybody out in the public square. So what Solomon is setting up is, look, this world is deceptive. Satan is deceptive. Our flesh is weak. We end up on the wrong path at the wrong time in the wrong place. You've got to be able to discern. And how do you do that? You wear it in your heart and you act appropriately. So wisdom first dwells within us, and then it leads us to act appropriately so that we're not caught on the wrong path at the wrong time in the wrong place. So the woman lies to the man. She says she has an obligation to offer sacrifices to fulfill her vows to God, that she needs to make money for the sacrifices, despite the fact that that is forbidden. They should know that when they're studying the Pentateuch here in Deuteronomy 23:18. It says this: "You shall not bring the fee of a prostitute or the wages of a dog into the house of the Lord your God in payment for any vow, for both of these are an abomination to the Lord your God." That's exactly what's happening here, isn't it? Yep, right here we have exactly that happening. Later then, as we read, she says she needs funds because her husband took a long trip. All of this is simply to ease the conscience of the young man. She's religious after all. She just wants to pay her proper sacrifice for her vows that she's made. She's trying to fulfill her promise to God. Does Satan not act the exact? This is how Satan works. This type of religion is an abomination to God. To say that the ends justifies the means, that sinful actions are okay if you say they are necessary to accomplish a pious purpose? No. This is what we might call convenient religion. It lowers God's law. It perverts God's law to make God's law easier so that we can claim to be a good person. We hear this all the time. We hear churches in America saying, well, you know, God will love me no matter what because I'm trying my best. That's taking God's law and bringing it down to the level that we can meet. Now that I've brought God's law down, his commands down, now I can meet those commands. I can meet that law. I can do that good. Because after all, God created me sinful. Wow, that's turning right back on God, isn't it? Like Adam in the Garden of Eden. The woman that you gave me, the law that you commanded, I couldn't reach God, so I just brought it down. No. Law is to drive us to our knees so that we look for Christ, so that we look for wisdom, so that we go to God and repent of our sins, because God's forgiveness is free for all. See, this allows us, when we have convenient religion, when we lower God's law or we change it to be something that we can do, it allows us to ignore our sin or to explain it away. Thus, we don't need to rely fully upon Christ. That's what our heart desires. That's what Satan tries to get us to do, to twist God's word, to twist his law, to lower it down to a place where we can meet it. And thus, I don't need Christ. And if I don't need Christ, then I'm fine. Then I don't need church. I don't need to pray. I don't need to read the Bible. I don't need to spend time in devotion. I'm good. And so when I get to the pearly gates, God will accept me for who I am because I tried my best. And that's the final point. And Jesus will say, "Depart from me. I never knew you." We can't do that with the law. When we see the law, it's got to strike our heart so that we, like the Jewish people in Acts, when at the day of Pentecost said, you know, they're cut to the heart and they said, "What must we do to be saved?" Don't lower God's law. What did Peter say? "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, for this promise is for you and for your children, all who are far off." All right, so that's what this woman is doing. She is perverting God's law. She's saying, "Hey, I'm just trying to make some money so I can fulfill my vows to God. I need to have a sacrifice. I need some money. So come help me make money. It'll be a good transaction. You'll get what you want, and I'll get what I want, and we'll all have fun, and we'll appease what God has commanded." She continues, the furniture that she's preparing, it's the same as the married couple in the Song of Solomon. Look specifically at chapter 1, 16 and 3, verse 1. The spices she uses are the same as those for married couples in Psalm 45, verse 8, Song of Solomon 4, 6, and several others. She's trying to be deceptive. That's all it is. That's what Satan is. Remember Satan, the angel of light? He tries to deceive. He tries to make it seem like all is good, like that's just fine to do. So this is the issue. This is what we've got to look out for in this world. Satan, who's acting like an angel of light and trying to deceive us, trying to get us to walk on the wrong path, to follow after our own heart's desires, to bring God's law down. And it's a reminder also that these spices are used in death. In John 19, 39, the burial of Christ. So, the woman has baited the trap, and she now is getting ready to make her proposition. The words that she speaks are sacred, but she profanes them. Here's what I was just talking about. She's counterfeiting the holy and the divine. This is what Satan does. He takes what's holy and divine and counterfeits it. Smooth, the word that you saw a couple of times, it characterizes her words and her lips. The foolishness of the young man makes him vulnerable like an animal in a trap. Only the woman speaks here, and only the woman takes action. We're told Solomon sees a man doing this, but we only hear from the woman, and we only see the actions of the woman beyond the man walking the wrong path. And it, what? So the woman, she speaks, takes action, it leads to death and the eternal grave as opposed to a marital relationship that we read in Song of Solomon. Both husband and wife speak, both husband and wife love one another, and their love overcomes death and the grave. Here in Proverbs, the man and the adulteress, they're acting selfishly in order to fulfill their own desires, and that's the big difference there. Economic desires and lustful desires. The woman has her economic desires. She wants money. The man has his lusting desires. He wants sex. These desires are contrary to God's will, and it lead to eternal death. So Solomon closes with a warning to his sons to not adopt the ways of the woman. Metaphor of the path. One leads to life. One leads to death. So the self-centered nature shown here, the man only wanting to satisfy the desires of his flesh rather than satisfy and be obedient to God, the woman only wanting the money rather than being faithful to her husband and to God. Self-centered nature. That's what sin does. We say in curvatus se, it turns us in on ourselves. And that's a contrast to the mutual relationship intended by God in marriage. I have on there Colossians 3, 18 to 19, but if we're going to talk marriage, I'll read that one for you. So it's only two verses. I want to end with Ephesians then, since we are talking so much about marriage. So maybe I'll just pull it up over here. Colossians 3, 18 to 19. Just give me a second to pull it up on my other computer or on my other screen. There we go. Show you over here. Here it says, wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Two verses can easily be misconstrued in our day and age. If I can type here, I'm going to go to Ephesians, where am I at? I should have read the full chapter. I am on the wrong chapter. There we go, 22. All right. So here, if we're talking husbands and wives and how we ought to act, we should not be selfish like the adulteress and the man on the wrong path. Here it says, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Nowadays, that word submit is very harsh in our culturally sensitive ears. We don't like it. We don't like it because we are sinful people. And it's not acted upon correctly, it's not understood right. So what are they submitting to here, really? Let's talk about God's kingdom. So the role for the husbands, looking at verse 25, Love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Before we even go any further, simply taking that verse, wives, women, would you be willing to submit to a husband who loved you like Christ loved you? Would you be willing to submit to a man who gives himself up for you, who will do everything to take care of your every need, who will put you first? That is what, when we get these two together, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. Why? Because husbands are to love you and give themselves up for you. So when both are acting accordingly, the man is to take care of his wife by putting her needs first, by giving up of himself to take care of her. So when all things are working well together, this is how God's kingdom runs. Remember what Jesus said, and this is our theme for the year, sent to serve. Jesus said, the Son of Man came not to be served, but in order to serve. So God, who's at the top, brings himself down to the bottom in order to serve us. That's how God's kingdom works. In the Gentile world, in the earthly realm, the ruler's at the top, and the rulers tell other people what to do. So when we hear wives submit to your husbands, in the earthly realm, they're thinking the husband's at the top and telling the wife who's below him what to do to serve him. But God flips that upside down. Husbands are at the bottom. Husbands are to serve the wife, to serve the children, to serve the household. Husbands are called to serve the wife. So when we read it that way, wives, you're submitting to service, not to tyrannical rule, but to service. Do you understand what my hands are doing here? God's kingdom flips everything upside down so that the one at the top, God, is actually at the bottom serving us. So husbands, if you're going to serve your wife, guess what? You need to be served. You need to be served by God. God is the basis of all, which means you need to be going to church. You need to be bringing your wife to church because that's what she needs most. You need to bring your children to church because that's what they need the most. Whew, I could go off for a long time on that. So wives, husbands, women, yes, you submit to your husband because your husband is to give himself up for you. Husbands, you ought to love your wife as Christ loved you and as Christ loved the church, giving himself up for her and for you. All right? At the end, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. And I'll close on this one. There's a whole Bible study I want to do with husbands and wives on this. Men need to be respected. That's what we crave deep down, to be respected. If we're giving up of ourselves, we need to be respected. Women crave love. They want to know that the man loves them and will attach himself to her. So that's why Paul here talked about husbands, love your wife. The women need love. And that's why he says, wife, respect her husband. Men need respect. Now, men, you know the old joke. The woman, the wife says, he doesn't love me. And he goes, yes, I did. I said it the day we got married. If it changes, I'll let you know. Tell your wife that you love her. Learn her love language. How does she know that you love her? Is it acts of service? Is it gifts? Is it time away? Is it time together? What is it that makes her feel loved? That's how you tell her you love her. For me, my wife loves acts of service. So if I do the dishes, my wife feels loved. All right. So I got to close there. That's the end of our Bible study on Proverbs. We are through the 10 addresses from father to son. I want to thank you for joining us thus far. For next time in Proverbs chapter 8, the blessings of wisdom. It's wonderful. So next time, join us for the blessings of wisdom. Let's close with prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, thank you for the gifts of Proverbs. Thank you for the gift of husbands and wives. Thank you, most importantly, for the gifts of your Son, Jesus Christ, wisdom incarnate. May we bind it upon our hearts and tie it around our fingers and around our necks. May we internalize your word and live it out for all the world to see. May we continue to walk on the path. May we continue to be in the light. May we continue to shine that light for others to see. Bless us as we depart now. In your name we give you all thanks and praise. Amen. Thank you again for joining us this day.